DJ, you cannot pronounce anything. You're an idiot. Hello, everybody, and welcome to Dark DJ Productions. And today we're back on the Scotch Racetrack V2 for the final drive of Dark Drives in this little mini series on Glennock Creations' Scotch Racetrack V2. I know it's very sad, it's very upsetting, but all good things must come to an end. And today we finish our journey over Scotch Racetrack V2 with something a bit different. As you can probably tell from the diesel that we've got here, instead of doing something pre-grouping, so, you know, Caledonian Railway, Highland Railway, anything like that, and instead of doing anything from the grouping era, so the LMS era, or LNER, LNER, Southern, Great Western, blah, 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 I decided that we're going to do the BR era in the 70s. Now, the weird thing about that is this route clearly isn't built for that. This is a steam era route through and through. But I decided to push a little bit forward and do a what-if scenario of this being in the BR Blue era. Now, you might notice we've got a bit of lag. Now, that will die off and go away. The main reason that we've got lag is because we've got a 47 coming in with a high-intensity headlamp on, and it's draining my frames. So we'll see that in a few minutes. And at the moment, we're just watching this very slow Class 105 leave the station. It's a shame, really. If my computer's a bit beefier, that would look really smooth and lovely. But it is what it is. So what is our noble steed for this journey, and what is it we're doing? So we are at Trayman Castle. I believe that's still how it's pronounced. And we're going to be going up, quote-unquote, the main line. So the what is technically speaking part of the old Scotch Racetrack. I know we should have really got up the new bit a bit more, but I wanted to show off the main line a bit with one of my own scenarios. So the idea is we're here in a British Rail Class 40, an English Electric Type 4, and we are going to be taking a run up the line from here to the north of the map to the place that I can't pronounce. It's like Craigenlyle or something like that. With two stops on the way, one at Garglocken Junction, Langlocken Junction, whatever it's called, and another one at the station after that, which I can't remember the name of, because that's the beginning of the single track sections. Doesn't really matter. It's all fine. It'll be fine. We're going to do this run. Hopefully the 40 will just behave itself, and we'll be able to actually do the run proper. So, God, that Craven has taken a very long time to leave us, hasn't it? Although I think I can see the 47 is arriving too. So this is a scenario that I've built for Scotch Racetrack V2, hence why we're in the BR Blue era. And the idea, like I said, is that we're sort of in the maybe early to mid 70s. Not sure whether I've done all the livery justice. Not sure whether I've even got the correct liveries for the time. But do you know what? It's okay. Doesn't matter. Because it's for a bit of fun. And as you guys all know, I like a little bit of fun. So, yeah, we shall be leaving shortly. We're just going to wait for this train to come in. And then hopefully, if I press F3, we should see how long we've got to wait. Because we've actually got a timed wait here at Trayman Castle. And yes, I'll be driving with this HUD instead of the F5 HUD this time. Because when I drive diesels, this is the much preferred HUD to use. Mainly because I can also see where my stops are and all my instructions. Which are, there's only four. Because I'm not as good as other creators of scenarios, so my scenarios are a little bit pants. So yeah, as you can see on our right-hand side, there is a 47 coming in. Hopefully, by the time it passes us, we should see a little increase in frame rates. Because I think it's the high-intensity headlamps that do it. And I think it's also because I've got a load of diesel sat in a shed further down the line that might be interrupting. Anyway, that's enough of that. There we go. If I've now jumped in the cab, we can now see that the frame rate's improved ever so slightly. And it might not even... No, it wasn't even the 47. I have no idea what's causing the lag. It doesn't matter anyway, but let's get our loco set up. So, yeah, we're in a Class 40 today. So this should be interesting because there's a lot of steep climbs on this run. So fingers crossed, we should make it. I have tested this scenario. I can make it. I'm just really hopeful that I don't do something stupid like burn out a traction motor or something. And unfortunately, this wait is a little bit long. Because again, we've got to wait for that train. We've got to wait for passengers to get on. And hopefully, we should have it timed well enough that we will be able to pass a fair bit of AI traffic. Which is why, for the sake of this video, we're going to sit on this side of the cab. We're going to be in the second man's seat. So, despite this being a steam era route, actually, you can kind of convert it into an early 70s, you know, because it's in Scotland, it's in the, like, you know, you could imagine this is in the far north of Scotland. It might not be on the radar for British Rail to have modernised it as quickly as everywhere else. Maybe. So that's why there's no AWS, that's why there's no colour light. In fact, I think semaphores probably would have been in vogue and they would have been used right up until, I think it was probably throughout into modern day, actually. I'm sure there's some routes that still have semaphore signalling, don't know. But I've tried to dress up the route a little bit. I've tried to put some, the problem is the way I've done this, you can't actually see what I've done. But I've like had some sidings that are overgrown with, you know, grass and whatnot, lots of things like that. But you might spot them on the way up the line, we don't know. So our next stop on this section of the journey is Llangollen Junction. Okay, so let's take the brakes off. We're in forward gear. And let go. So the good thing is, it looks like the timing should work out fine because for some reason, I don't know why, but originally the game wanted me to go forward and then back into the station to collect passengers. I have no idea why that is. Doesn't really matter. It's fine. Oh look, so that's another thing we were waiting for. The reason we had such a long wait was to wait for that DMU to cross from the up line, I guess you'd call it like the up main, which is what we're on now, which is on the other side anyway, onto the up slow, you know, the up secondary, because that's going into another platform. So hopefully we should have a clear path now, because the other DMU that left should have sort of buggered off and should leave us to our own devices. Right. You might notice that I've turned the sounds up a little bit as well for this run. So, fingers crossed, we should, if I can get the speed down a little bit, because I didn't want to speed that much, because the whole point of this scenario through the testing it was to make sure that we actually go to the speed limit of the route. Because that way we'll see all the stuff we want to see. So actually, we will be able to see something I've done, which is, this used to be the main steam sheds at Trayren Castle. I still think that's how it's pronounced. And what I've done, if I just scooch the camera over here, is I've put all this grass in to make it look overgrown. Like, there's a bunch of diesels on shed. There's an O3 shunter there. There's some wagons there. So, you know, it makes it sort of look like it's being not modernised as such. Maybe modernised. But, you know, it's in its last sort of throes of its heyday and all these sidings and things are getting overgrown and they're going to be ripped up at some point. Yes, I know I'm speeding. Only a little bit. It doesn't matter anyway. Oh, look, it's a 25, I think that was meant to be. So that. I would have put some class 27s in, which are the, you know, quote-unquote muck rats, which are the Scottish ones. But for some reason, I couldn't get them to work. So in order to keep my requirements down on this scenario, I've just added some the BR Blue Era packs that DTG did a while ago. So that's why we've got, well, 47s are from the default. The 40 is from Railright, which is unfortunately not available to buy anymore, which I think is a real shame. Because the 40 is probably one of my favourite diesel locomotives in this game. And it's a very fun engine to drive. It's quite advanced. And I'm not really 100% sure why they withdrew it. I mean, I think the thing was is that Railright themselves turned around and said, oh, it's not up to our standard anymore. But then there was nothing to replace it once it had come out and once it had gone off sale. And I think that's a real shame because, again, the 40s, this is probably one of my favourite diesel locomotives to drive in train sim. In fact, it might actually be my favourite one to drive. I know it's a bit low on power, but that's kind of half the fun. So, yeah, I'm going to speed up a little bit. I'm going to break the speed limit slightly because I know we've got a heavy climb coming up. We've got to climb all the way. I think it's something like 10 miles of climbing. And here we go. There's a class 31. Again, I don't know whether these are prototypical for the time period, like, you know, early to mid 70s. And you can see a bit, you could see a little bit of overgrowth on that siding on the left there. So this isn't a very advanced scenario. It's literally just do four station stops. But I thought it'd be nice to actually run the mainline section of this route, because it's a nice run. It's a really nice mainline to run on. And the fact that it goes from double track for like something like 20-ish miles. And then it going back to sort of single track with passing loops for the final, I think it's like 8 miles, 9 miles. That's kind of fun. And it sort of gives you that kind of Scottish feel, actually. Or even like, you know, because some main lines do actually cut down into, you know, single track for some sections. I mean, I look at my local line, which is the Southwestern main line, that if you leave from, if you leave from Weymouth, it goes from being two track to Dorchester South, and then it goes single track from Dorchester South to Moreton, and then it goes back to double track up to, I think, Mitchell Dever, and then it goes to quadruple track most of the way into London from, like, Basingstoke, Woking area, I think. This is the interesting bit now, because we're now approaching the climb, which is like 1 in 90 odd. So, this is basically a cab ride, by the way. This is essentially, because I love the idea of just sitting here watching the scenery go by and kind of actually, because I know this little mini series on the Scotch Racetrack is supposed to be quote unquote challenge, and I've kind of tried to make it slightly easy for me in the last one, but I'm still using an advanced locomotive, because technically the 40s are a bit more advanced than your average diesel. Speaking of average diesels, look, here's some 37s on a van train, I think. Oh, yes, look at that. No idea if that would be prototypical, but someone did tell me the other day that vans, BR vans, might have still been used up until like the 70s or 80s while new rolling stock was being brought in. So, hopefully the weather should improve on our journey. I have made it so that the sun should pop out. It'd be nice if the lag went away, though, while it loads titles. Probably because I've been doing some other bits on the computer today. There you go, back to normal now. So, here we are approaching another tunnel. I'm trying to do this properly. Honk your horn when you go into tunnels. And I think I can see the little marks on the track, so that's good. Plus, the other thing you've got to be careful of on Class 40s is tripping the traction motors. And I think last time, because I did a drive on here, it's not this, obviously not this scenario, but I did a drive on here a little while ago with the 40, with a long heavy train. And I stopped at one of these stations, it might have even been this one. And I tried to restart the engine, and one of the traction motors blew out. I'm going to kind of horn, because there's a level crossing there, and there should really be a horn. So here we are, overtaking another service. Another passenger service, I think being headed by either another 40 or a 37. I think it's a 37, that is, yeah. We've got the clear path. So, yeah, it's not the most advanced scenario in the world. And I think anybody could sort of set a scenario like this up. There's a DMU there. Hello, DMU. Goodbye, DMU. So, it's not like I'll release this scenario, because no one requested my last scenario, so I could probably start actually adding a lot more random Easter eggs into these, like, for example, having DR1202 puff past on a train, or even having DR1202 be the player train in another scenario I might make. Who knows? But yeah, I might start doing, because I know I brought back dark drives with running these scenarios and things, but I might go back and do maybe some different routes and unusual routes. Maybe in quick drives, maybe just pick some random scenarios, just start doing a few more random bits and bobs. If people think like the idea of that, again, comment section is open, let me know. Because I don't know whether this is everybody's cup of tea. Still haven't really got the analysis for it. I mean, obviously, these aren't doing as well as, say, an episode of TDRS or something related to TDRS. But they're a nice steady video stream, and it's a nice steady content for everybody. And you get a lovely cab ride as well on the way. And you get to hear my lovely voice. And hopefully when I'm doing less of these sort of... I wouldn't say this is scripted. This is sort of just me sat here trying to make, you know, an edited video, a decent video. I mean, I don't even know whether I'm going to edit this video. This one is probably one of those episodes where it would have been better as a live stream. I might bring back the dark drives as live streams, perhaps, because essentially that's what these are. These are what I would do in a live stream, perhaps. But maybe I think it, because, I mean, the last video I did on this, up to about halfway, was brilliant. Hilarious. But when I got to the end, I knew I was getting tired. And I'd run out of things to say. And I think that I'm probably detrimental. But the beginning of the video, my lords, I really enjoyed putting that together. So, of this little mini-series, I'm hoping, on the Scotch Racetrack V2, that the second video should be the best of the three. Unless you like diesels, in which case this is clearly the best of the three. If you like the snow, the first episode is the best of the three. And if you really like lag, this is clearly the episode for you. Because it's lag central on this run for some unknown reason. I don't even know if any processes are running on my computer that might be causing it. Maybe something's running in the background? Who knows? Maybe I just need to upgrade my computer at some point. Which means I've got to get in contact with my mate Gwion. So Gwion, if you ever actually decide to watch this, mate, when do you fancy coming on a holiday down to where I live? I was about to say my house. Coming down to a holiday where I live and fixing up my computer again. How about that? What do you think? Problem is I need to save a lot of money before then. So, yeah. Well, that's why I'm doing overtime at work at the moment. Because, you know, it's coming up to December, coming up to Christmas. Oh, mate, look, it's number 40. Honk, honk. Oh, yeah. Do love a bit of 40 action. As you can tell, I love 40s. They're very pog. 40s are incredibly poggers. But, yeah, what was I saying? Oh, yeah, if Gwion wants to come down here for a holiday to upgrade my computer, unfortunately, I ain't got the money at the moment, but that's what I'm doing the overtime for. Coming up to Christmas, need to have some money in the bank so I can get my niece and nephew some stuff, and, you know, rest of my family and whatnot. But, yeah, money, need it. Everyone needs money. Money is one of those things that makes you wonder, actually, what would happen if money was no object? Like, if money didn't exist, how would the world function? It's a bit of a weird question, actually. I don't know how the world would function without money. Probably be a lot better, to be honest. But unfortunately, people wouldn't do anything if there was no motivation to do so. Money is kind of a motivating factor for anything, I think. Again, someone who is intelligent might tell me in the comments or something like that to say, oh yes, but if there was a cashless society with no money at all. I know cashless means something else, but if there was a society where money didn't exist, there would be, like, you know, chaos and nothing would be done and the economies would all tank. I don't know. Sometimes I do wonder. Would everybody be a lot happier? But then as a species, I suppose we as humans are quite selfish, sadly. I mean, look at railways. Let's go back on topic. Look at railways. We took natural landscapes such as this and we carved our way through it, build bridges and, you know, smash up things and dig down into mines and whatnot with rails and things for our convenience. We are quite selfish, aren't we? I'm not. I'm great. I'm lovely. So I'm told. Not by my other half. She tells me that I'm not lovely. But that's a story for another day and probably a story for another drive. Because I'm not really sure what else... we got a tunnel coming up. Not sure really what the topic is today. I don't really think I have a topic in this mini series. This is why I think if I make another one of these and I sort of record it as like a quick drive or a live stream or something, I might try and get some more people in. Because over the course of doing these, as much as I love talking, I have kind of noticed that I think I think that'd be better if there was another person in with me. Unless people like my ramblings on my own, because sometimes I can say some really funny crap. So, I don't know, maybe I'll try and get somebody in. maybe I'll look at that 47 and think, what are you doing with your life? You and your parcel train. What are you doing with your life? I know, I'm just chatting balls at the moment, to be perfectly honest. There's no whistle sign again. I'm sure we should be whistling at level crossings. Especially on gated level crossings. Yikes. See, doing this scenario has actually made me think. What if, when Scotch Racetrack V2 finally releases, I wonder if someone's going to go through it and make it modern. Maybe I will. Maybe I'll replace the signal with colour lights. Maybe I'll take up all the yards. Maybe that's a project for me to do. But then again, I say that, I'm still supposed to be modifying the Island of Sodor room. And I haven't finished doing that either. All I've done is scenerise the Farka branch. And a little bit of Gordon's Hill. And some other small places. And that's something I actually need to get on with at some point. Ooh. I think we're nearing the top of the incline. And we've not done bad, to be honest. I mean, I don't know how long my train is. Should we count? Let's see if we can get a line side shot. I know I said this was going to be a cab ride. But let's watch the 40 go by. I know I'm running without lights. I don't care. So we got, let's see, load 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. We got load 10. Load 10's not bad, actually, on a 1 in 93 gradient with a single class 40. And we haven't burnt out our traction motors, I don't think. Let me just flick over. Nope, we're still good for traction motors, too. Egg salad, and we're at the top of the hill. So, from this point onwards, ideally, we should be plain sailing, because from the top of the incline, we essentially coast most of the way down to the final station, which I still can't pronounce. It's like Craig and Lyle or something like that. I still don't think I can pronounce Larglocken Junction. Larglocken Junction. Is it Larglocken? I think it's Larglocken. I think I'm a Glockenspiel. Larglockenspiel. Anyway, look, it's a another Goyle. Nice. Ah, that's something I could talk about. Diesel nicknames. And some of the strange ones. So, as a lot of people know, actually, the title of this video is actually appropriate because this scenario is called Whistling While You Work. Whistling While You Work, even. Then, Class 40s were known as Whistlers. I'm not actually still sure why they were called Whistlers. I don't know whether it's due to the turbo or something. But 40s were known as Whistlers. 47s were called Spoons. Why were 47s called Spoons? That's a weird nickname. And as I just had the 31 go by, I called it a Goyle. And I can't remember what the nickname comes from, but I like the nickname Goyle for them. They're also known as Peds, I think. And I think also Skinheads for the 31s without the head code box on the roof. What other nicknames are there? So let me go through. So there wasn't a nickname for the 01s, 02s, or 03s, 04s, like 05s, 06s. I don't think 07's got a nickname either. But 08s, 9s, 10s, 11s, 12s, and the solitary 13s, well, solitary, the free 13s, kind of known as Gronks. I'm not quite sure whether that was an old nickname. Maybe it was an old nickname for 060 shunting engines, and they just picked it up. Then you got 14s, which are the teddy bears. And I think the reason behind that was that when Swindon Works were told they were building them, someone turned around somewhere and said, well, we built the Great Bear, now we're going to build a teddy bear. And I think that's where the nickname for the Class 14s comes from. 15s and 16s, I don't think, have nicknames. Claytons are Class 17s. 18s? Was there a Class 18? My brain can't visualise a Class 18 or 19. Maybe there wasn't an 18 or 19. You had Class 20s, which were choppers. And I think that was because of the sound their engines made. Oh, speaking of things that make loud noises, there's a DMU wheeling past us. 21s? Were they baby warships? 21s and 29s, I think, were baby warships, because the 29s were rebuilds of 21s. 22. 22s? Unless it was 22s that were baby warships. 23s, I think, were baby Deltics. And that's because they were just smaller Deltics, essentially. And they had one Deltic engine. 24s, 25s, and 26s were VATs. And the reason for that, I think, was that they were common as VATs. So you could find them anywhere. 27s were Muckrats, because they were the Scottish region of that type. 28s were Metrovics, or Kobos, because they had the weird Kobo wheel arrangement, and most people know them as Boko from Tomy the Tonkin Donkin. Was there a class 29? There was a class 30. That was what the 31s were originally called. The 31s were originally called class 30s. Then they became 31s. Don't think there's a class 32. 33s were Cromptons, because of the Crompton Parkinson, I think that's what they were called, but the Crompton equipment they had, basically. I don't know if it was a generator or something like that. I know it certainly wasn't the lag. You had 34s didn't exist. So then what? 35s? Those are Hymex, and that was because of their hydraulic equipment, I think. There was no 36, as far as I know. 37s were tractors, because of the sound of their engines. 38s and 39s, no. We talked about 14 being Whistlers. The original class 41 was warship, and so were the class 42 and 43s. They were warship because they were named after warships. 44s, 5s and 6s were peaks, because the 44s were named after British and Scottish and, I don't know whether Irish and Welsh, mountains. So they were peaks. 47s were spoons. 48s, I think, were basically 47s. Oh God, I think I'm coming a little bit hot. I don't want emergency. I just want normal braking. And a bit of lag again for some reason. Which means that we're going to fail miserably at this station shop. Stop, I think. Although the train should be long enough. We should be alright. I think after we go past the lag stops, because there's something over there that's causing a bit of lag. There we go, that's better. So where are we? 48s? Yeah, they were basically 47s. But I think they had uprated engines or something. There were no 49s. Yeah, class 50s, which were Hoovers. Because when they were originally built, they had some sort of like vacuum equipment or something. It might have been air filters, actually, on top of their on top of them, and that caused them. Excuse me. Why won't you? Oh, I think I've got to move forward a little bit. And that caused them to sort of make sucky sounds like a vacuum cleaner. So they were called, well, they were called either Vacs and or Hoovers. 51s. Can't recall 51s. 52s were Westerns. Because they were all named Western and then something. 53 was Falcon, which was the only prototype of its type. There we go, now the doors are opening. 54s, no. 55s were Deltics because of their engines. 56s were Grids because of the gridirons on the front of their horn covers. Oh God, that's let us go already. Jeez, okay. That was a quick station stop. But it's fine. It's fine. We shall continue anyway. 57s are body snatchers, because they're essentially class 47s but re-engined. 58s were bones, because if you look at them top down, they look like the classic depiction of a bone. 59s were super sheds. 60s were tugs. I don't know if they're 61, 62, 63, 64, 65. 66s are sheds. 67s are skips. There isn't a 68. 69s are... Oh, God, I gave these a nickname because the new class 69s are the re-engined 57s. 56s, even. So they're basically super grids. So they're something like grid snatchers or something like that. I don't actually know what the official nickname for the 69s are. Oh, no, they're called cheekies. Because 69, haha. Well, I'm coining that phrase. That's my phrase now. They're cheekies. And then I think the 70s are Predators, because they look like the Predator from the Predator films. After that, that's about all the Diesel nicknames I know. I think. I've probably missed some. Those are just my general knowledge Diesel nicknames for everyone to laugh at and point at me and say, "Ah, you missed one. Ah, you missed something like, I don't know, you missed the nickname for the Body Snatchers. They were actually also called Zombies." Which I think they were actually called Zombies. So, yeah, that was a really boring segue of common knowledge that people probably already know. Let's get back to driving. God, how long did that bit take? And how bad did my voice break, I wonder? Where are these whistle boards, man? I'm supposed to be honking for the crossings. We're also not supposed to be going this fast. So let's add a little bit of breakage. Yeah, this is the weird challenge about going downhill now. I've got to keep an eye on the braking, because I don't want to put the brakes on for too long. But I also don't want the train to slow down too much. Oh, I just missed another crossing. Darn it. Bit of silence there, just to confuse everybody. So what is our next station? Cairnkeld. Or Cairnkeld? How'd you pronounce that? Cairnkeld? Something like that. Doesn't matter anyway. I think the way I've set the scenario up, we've got a little bit of a tiny bit of a wait at Cairnkeld. I don't know how to pronounce these Scottish names. I'm really sorry, everyone. I know throughout this whole video there's somebody out there is screaming at their at their monitor or their phone or whatever device they're watching this on and going, "Dark DJ, you cannot pronounce anything. You're an idiot." Maybe not in Sid's voice, but maybe in a Scottish accent or something like that. I can't do Scottish either. I don't know. Anyway, someone's out there somewhere. Oh, look, double header. Someone out there is shouting at me and saying I can't pronounce Scottish names for shit. Which is true, I can't. But then again, I'm not Scottish, I'm Southern. And according to somebody, I have a posh accent. I do not. I have a nasally accent. As you can tell when I talk, all I can hear when I talk is just all the noise is coming through my nose. So I sound like I've permanently got something stuck up my nose. Like that. And it's terrible. Terrible business. Which is probably why I sound like... I don't know how I sound like that. It might be because I don't have any tonsils or adenoids. I had them removed when I was a child. I don't remember why. Maybe because my tonsils were like strangling me to death or suffocating me. Which, I don't know. Dunno. If I were in the self-deprecation mood, or defecation, whatever it's called. Not defecation. That's self-shitting mood, yes. If I was in the mood to sort of put myself down, I would say, oh yeah, they were like choking me as a child. Oh, maybe they should have carried on. Oh, brakes. So, no, it's fine. It's only a joke. I wouldn't make that sort of joke. Unless, of course, I was around my friends, in which case I would say, yeah, go on, kill me. Go on, just kill me. Or, like I was at work one day when I was saying to my colleague, I'd love to just, you know, sometimes with mean people or the horrible people that are in the world, I'd love to just grab a big old knife and just lob it at the middle of their foreheads. Again, to clarify, I am joking. I'm not a murderer. I've only murdered fictional characters, okay? Not characters like Peppa Pig. Don't worry, I haven't made a bacon sandwich out of her yet. Jesus, I did it with Daddy Pig. But I don't murder real people. I just murder fictional characters, like, you know, characters in my show, because, you know, some of them got burnt to death, so they're a bit toasty. Anyway, we're approaching a 40 zone, so I think we should slow down. Ha! He said 40 zone! You're in a class 40! That's really funny! Ha ha ha! Yes, it is very funny. But now is not the time to joke, everybody. I hope throughout my random ramble, everybody's enjoyed the cab ride so far. And in fact, look, the sun's popping out now. So we went from being cloudy to sort of more, you know, the sun popping out a bit, which is really unusual for Scotland, isn't it? Didn't I ask a lot? Isn't it always raining in Scotland? Yeah, but then if I had done this scenario in the rain, it wouldn't have been visually appealing, would it? Everyone would have gone, oh, I can't see a thing because it's so dark and muddy and rainy and everything. And then I'd have had to turn around and say, well, I'm doing prototypical Scotland. In which case, somebody would have probably moaned at me and said, you can't say that. That's racist to the Scottish. Am I clear? Yeah, I'm clear. Good. I was really worried then. I thought, why is my signal not dropping? Why is my signal not dropping? I'm sure this is where I'm meant to stop, but I'm meant to go into the station. So yeah, what I've done now, you can probably tell that this used to be some sort of yard of some sort, but now it's just sort of like storage sidings and whatnot for like engineering trains. So, you know, there is kind of something to be said if you can make a scenario similar to this, where you can modify the route in the scenario editor and sort of make it look a bit more, I don't want to say modern, but, you know, make it fit a time period, perhaps. So what we're going to... Oh, excuse me. I can hear an ambulance somewhere. What we're going to do is we're going to park the engine just beyond the station, because the train itself, as long as the train itself is in the station, we should be good. And as long as we don't approach the signal too quickly, we should be good. So if we just press the button, allow people to get on and off. I know they're going to be really quick. I still haven't nailed down how to get the station stop to actually occur for a length of time. The only way I've ever managed to get it to work is if you make it a timetable scenario and make it a time stop. You might notice that I'm attempting not to skip forward for this bit. I don't think I'm going to cut this bit. I'm just going to talk through it because I know that somewhere up the line, a diesel multiple unit is roaring towards us and is going to jump into the other platform, and then we're going to bugger off to Craigenline Joint Station, apparently, which is 9 miles away. So you can probably tell as well we've got a few more engineering trains and stuff in the sidings here. Kind of just adds the atmosphere. Oh, there's the DMU there. Look, there it is. Hello. What are you doing here? Oh, wait. Yeah, I know you were coming. Hello? Is it Bree you're looking for? I might use that as the intro. Don't know yet. I don't really know, to be fair. But then to DMU, which means if we take our brakes off and then get honk if you're horny. And then I think we can 420 blaze it. Yep, there you go. Signal green. Let's go. Let's 420 blaze it, St. Michael. Don't know where that turn of phrase comes from, but oh well. So now it gets a bit slower. Now we're on what I would call the slow section of Scotch Racetrack, so it's not really racetrack now. Which reminds me, why? I don't know whether Glennock Creations are going to watch this video. I won't say I doubt. I know they will because they wanted me to do these and they want to see these. Why is it called the Scotch Racetrack when there's only a small section of very fast running on that mainline bit? Why not call it, I don't know, the Scotch Jogging Circuit or the Scotch Egg? Scotch Egg. Yeah, there you go. You could have called it the Scotch Egg. No one would have noticed. But I don't know. It just seems funny to call it racetrack when there's some sections of really slow speed. I mean, the route's lovely. The route's great. I've enjoyed my time on Scotch Racetrack V2. I just don't know why it's called racetrack. Daytona. I don't know. But there's some really pretty bits on this section, actually. Because that 25 zone that we're approaching, a rather rapid pace, I might add, is over a really nice viaduct. And I think it's inspired by Glenfinnan Viaduct, which is all kinds of thumbs up. Because I literally put my thumb up, noticing that and remembering, because I'm a dum-dum, that I don't record with a web camera, so nobody can see me putting my thumb up. Mainly because I don't think anybody wants to see my face. Like, I've done it before. My face, not something you want to look at. Especially as I get older, it's like all wrinkly and, you know, I've got a beard and, well, kind of a beard. It's more like scraggle, I'd call it. So, yeah, that's why I don't record with my webcam, because, yeah, I'm ugly. And I don't particularly like to advertise my ugliness a lot of the time. Thank you very much. I do enough of that when I'm out and about. All right, let's slow it down to 25 as we come on to Fake Villain Viaduct. Fake Finn and Viaduct? But yeah, obviously when you guys actually download this route, if and when you download the route, if you've even got train sim, you might just be watching this because you haven't got train sim and you want to see what it's like. But look at this. It's a really nice curved, sharply curved viaduct. Do you know what? This extra line, because I just saw all that open space on the right-hand side, this section of line has to be closed during stormy weather. If there's wind, that's going to blow your train off the track if it's coming at the right direction. Has that ever happened? Has a train ever been blown off a bridge? Is that something that can occur? Am I imagining it? Has that happened before? Comment section, people, please tell me. Is there any situation where an engine or train has been blown off a bridge? You know, broadsided off a bridge? I'm interested to know now. But yeah, if you're only watching for the cab ride or to see the route itself and haven't got train sim or something, then I hope you've liked it. I hope you've enjoyed. Horn. I keep forgetting to do it on those bits. Otherwise, if you have got train sim, I thoroughly recommend downloading this route. Especially if you want something more steam era, something that you can potentially be anywhere. But more importantly, if you've got lots of Chris's Caledonian locomotives and LMS era locomotives. Because I actually am kind of keen to see if somebody would maybe make a scenario pack for this with more in the way of appropriate engines for the region. Maybe. I mean, I would tackle it, but again, my scenario creation skills are quite limited, as you can tell, because I've literally just made a very simple go from A to B scenario. And last time, I don't even know how I managed to build that scenario on Dorset Coast. I think it's because there's lots of double track. No, there isn't lots of double track, though, is there? Because there's less double track on there than there is here. I don't know. But there are more talented scenario creators out there. Like I said, I like to just do simple drive from point A to point B with lots of AI trains and lots of static trains looking nice in sidings, such as that one. Another pretend McRat. Waiting with some wagons for some reason. Maybe it's dead. Maybe it died. Maybe it became a lump of scrap. Nah, it couldn't have done. It was still alive. So, this has got a really nice feel to it, this single track bit. Because I know we've done the branch before, but it has a different atmosphere. Probably because it's meant to be a main line. Like, brakes, please. I don't want to speed. Don't want to speed too much. How far have we got to go anyway? 6 miles? That's not too bad. Don't know what the length of this video is, actually. I should really check. I think I shall. Well, so far, it's telling me that I've recorded 42 minutes of footage. So, if this video is about, I don't know, 50 minutes, then I don't think I've edited much out. If it's like 30 minutes, then you know I've edited a lot out. Maybe including this bit. Who knows? Maybe I edit this bit out. Maybe I use this bit as the intro just to fool everybody. Ah, now you're thinking with portals. Or am I? Dun dun dun. Don't know. Again, me, Dark DJ Productions, DDJP, Dark, being crazy as usual. It's funny actually. I've just said that. I actually don't like my nickname. Because when I hear people refer to me as Dark, I find it really weird. I think, like most of the time, I just prefer it if people should call me Tom. Because I hate my birth name. It basically, I won't say, well, you know what it is. It's in the credits every time and it's on my channel. But I don't like the long version of my name. So I've always, it's weird. When I was younger, I insisted that everybody called me by my full name. But as soon as I was sort of like in school, coming out of school, going into sixth form, I was like, actually, no, I don't want people to call me that anymore. And ever since then, it's just been like, no, just call me Tom. It's easier. It's short. It's easy to say. It's quick. And it doesn't make me sound like a toff. So, yeah. Anyway, that's the origin of my name. I guess. So, really clutching at straws for things to talk about now, ladies and gents. Although, what? Why is this a 50 zone? Why is this a Hoover zone when it goes back to a rat zone? Yes, that's right. I'm trying to confuse people by using diesel misnomers to describe speed limits. So it goes from VAC. Oh, goodness, we really are speeding a little bit now. It goes from VAC to VAT to VAC again. And then probably going to old classification for goils somewhere. Then I think you're going back to VATs. I should do that all the time with speed limit, just to confuse the heck out of people. Just like, oh yeah, I'm approaching a VAT limit. What's a VAT limit? Oh, 25 mile per hour zone. Why didn't you just say that? Because VAT limit is funnier and it confuses you. Oh, look, we're on the main line. We're now going to be doing predator speeds. What's a predator speed? We're doing 70, my guy. So what did I say for 80, 95, 100? Well, 100, I'll just say, oh, I'm doing City of Truro. And then somebody will come into the comments inevitably and say, don't you mean a Flying Scotsman? No, City of Truro. That's literally the main reason that City of Truro is in preservation. Doesn't matter if it actually did 100 miles an hour or not. The fact it's preserved and we've got an engine of that sort of design, you know, outside frame, but with a modern, you know, a modern tapered boiler. Oh, speed limit change. I think that's really nice. Even if it didn't, I mean, lots of people say, oh yeah, it couldn't have broken the record. It couldn't have like done 100 miles an hour. But do we really know that? I don't know. I know Scotsman was authenticated for it, and Mallard is still the fastest steam engine in the world. But that feels kind of hollow when you consider that, you know, we had diesel locomotives able to go at like 150 miles an hour at one point, I think. Clever crossing. Oh look, there's another ped, skinhead. With a train. Nice. Also, I don't know whether I really should have been stopping at all of these stations, but I'm in a 40. This is an express. This is a direct train from London. We ain't got time for that. So, can't remember what I was saying now. Oh, I think I'm talking about speed limits. And oh, I'm talking about diesels, weren't I? Beating steam speed record. I think some of them even go like 130, 140 odd. So it kind of feels hollow that we've got a steam engine that went 126 miles an hour. Yet we've got technology like, I mean, crumbs, you know, electrics can go up to like, I'm sure some electrics can go over 200 miles an hour in the right circumstances. I don't think they really count as trains in the traditional sense, but maglevs in, I think it's Japan and China, one of the two. Might be Japan, mainly. But anyway, maglevs, they can just go, meow, they go like 500, 600 miles an hour. It's like, whoa, that snail is fast. So, it just makes you think, doesn't it? Like, it's to be honest, it's the same as things like the Concorde. We built, it's not the same, but I want to talk about it now. We built the fastest, you know, like the Mach 2, you know, supersonic airliner. We also had the Tupolev Tu-144, which was the Soviet equivalent, but we don't talk about that due to fear of things. And also because, which is funny, because I actually really like the Tu-144. I love the Tu-144. So let me rephrase that then. So we built the Tu-144 and the Concorde, which were supersonic airliners, but we've never built another one. And we've gone backward. Now we're back to flying, you know, two-engine planes that only do about 500 miles an hour. I say only, but that's still pretty quick. And certainly quicker than Mallard, isn't it? You know, they can do 500, 600 odd miles an hour. Yet, so we've gone backward. But then you think about it, we've actually kind of not. Because where you used to do a business meeting, let's say you work in London and you live in New York and you had to fly over to London to have a business meeting. With the advent of things like the internet, you can have that connection instantly. And I think that's what's really killed travel. So, this is a really bizarre topic. I'm really sorry. I've kind of gone all over the place today with this scenario. I think it's because I know this is the last one of this little mini-series. And we've got 2 miles to go, 2.5 miles to go. So, yeah. But transport. Maybe I'll talk about transport in a future one. because I do like I say, I really like the supersonic airliners. Maybe not so fond of military vehicles. Not so much. Like tanks. I'm not really the biggest fan of tanks. But I like planes. I like commercial aircraft, anyway. I like ships. Ocean liners, even. A big fan of ocean liners. Not so much, again, not so much the military side of things. And like trains, obviously. Not so much buses. What other sort of transports are there? There's helicopters. Cars, I like cars. Yeah, I like cars. Cars are cool. Yeah, maybe I'll talk about transport properly in a future video. I'll talk about things such as, I can give you my opinions on things such as, was the Titanic and the Olympic really swapped over? Spoiler alert, no they weren't. As much as I used to joke about it and like, oh yeah, but like when you actually look at all the evidence together, it's like, no, they weren't. We talk about things like the RMS Queen Mary being docked in Long Beach, California. Lovely old ship. Too bad that everybody thinks it's a haunted house now. I don't know. There's also the H4 Hercules, the quote-unquote Bruce Goose, which Howard Hughes hated the nickname of. He hated the nickname Bruce Goose, apparently. But I'm glad that thing survives, actually. And the fact, actually, I say about the Queen Mary, there was a time, once upon a time, that the Queen Mary, in her docking area, in her, like, area where she lives now, the Spruce Goose was actually put next to her for a while. The H4 Hercules. And the H4, if anyone's wondering what the hell I'm talking about, the H4 Hercules is the world's largest aircraft. It was the largest aircraft at the time. I think it's still the largest by wingspan. Basically, it's really big. Which also reminds me, oh no, I just reminded myself that we lost the world's biggest aircraft, the Antonov AN-225. Ah, oh, I like that plane. Never saw it in real life, though. I wish I had. I wish I'd have been able to see it when it did some of its cargo runs over to the UK. Aw, oh, that makes me sad now. Which is funny, though, because I did see Concorde. I remember very vividly watching Concorde land somewhere. Can't remember which airport it was. It must have been my local airport, which I'm not going to spoil. Although people know me, they know what my local airport is. But yeah, I've seen Concorde in the flesh. I've also been to the Fleet Air Arm Museum, actually, up in Yeovilton. And, is it Yeovilton? Wherever it is. Oh, look, we're passing another piece of AI. I think this is the last piece of AI, actually. But yeah, I've seen one of the prototype Concords as well. I'm kind of ruining it, aren't I? Because really, oh, look at all the parcels. Lots of parcel trains on this run today. I'm kind of spoiling it because, like, I'm talking about transport now, and I could really save that as a full topic for another video. Maybe with someone. Who knows? Again, I need my comment section to speak to me and tell me what they'd like to see on these things. I'd like that. Or are people just fed up with it? If people just want me to stop doing these and concentrate on my show, again, that's, you know, let me know. But it'll be a shame to stop doing these, because I've enjoyed doing these. They're nice and relaxing, mostly. And it's just kind of nice to just sit here, drive a train, talk about things. Nice. Haven't been really nice. But as we're now approaching the end of our journey, can't pronounce the station, line station. I guess it's time to wrap up about Scotch Racetrack V2. Well, all I can say is that I hope the footage that you've seen and the scenarios that I've run will make you sort of happy and excited for when version 2 comes out. You can still, I mean, I think I've got it linked in the description. You can go and download Scotch Racetrack V1, which is basically the previous two scenarios, so the branch line and the main line. Those parts of the route are available at the moment, but they're obviously, they've been updated since. So you can go and download the V1 of Scotch Racetrack. And I thoroughly recommend it. And when version 2 comes out, I thoroughly recommend it. It's a really well-detailed, nice route. Yeah, I've had a few lag spikes here and there. But overall, I've really enjoyed my time with this route. Question is, though, have I enjoyed it more than Dorset Coast? Dorset Coast is my local. You can't beat it. Dorset Coast did my thing. Love Dorset Coast. But I'm equally happy to say that I've enjoyed Scotch Racetrack, and the team at Glennock Creation should be really happy with themselves because they've done a really good job. And thanks again for letting me do these videos, for showing people this route, you know. I know I've done it before, but this is a bit more of me being serious now. You know, it's been really nice. And I'm probably not going to be this praiseful of, obviously, payware routes and things. Because at the end of the day, these guys have done this for free. And they've done a good job. And there's also lots of diesels here that we're going to look at. See, look, there's no 3, 47, 37, another Goyle. What's that there? Another 37, 31 again, and a 40 again. Am I actually clear to come into the station? What? Don't you dare. Why are we denied into here? Well, it hasn't failed me. We're allowed to go into the station, so why were we denied access? You can't deny access for me! This is my scenario, bitch! How dare you! Anyway, things aside that haven't worked out quite as well as we expected, I really hope people have enjoyed this one. Because apart from the lag, which is probably my own fault for putting all this AI down on this one. Yeah, been a good route. Been a good time. Been a great time. We've had a good time. And I hope everyone else has had a great time too. It's some Cravens, isn't it? That's what's causing the lag. It's the Cravens. Really? The 105s all this time and what's been causing the lag? Got to be. Wow. Wow. That's a bit sucky. Anyway, enough of that. We've made it to the end of the line and the end of the scenario. Well done, team. So, oh hello. End of the line. Ooh, there's an engine hiding up here. Oh dear, that's not preserved, is it? Oh my god! Anyway, that is lag central because of the diesel I put in. So I guess this is the best place to stop, because if I stop here, maybe it'll look like there isn't as much lag. So, yeah, that's been Scotch Racetrack 3-2, Dark Drives, 3 scenarios, mostly successful, and hopefully enjoyable. Really, really hope you guys have enjoyed this. And I will see you all in the next video, whatever that may be. Have a great day, everyone, and goodbye.